Welcome to Afterthoughts, the podcast where we give you our thoughts after we watch a movie. I am your host, Michael Dixon. We have the normal crew with us this week. Ryan King, how's it going?
It's good. Dressed up like a million-dollar trooper trying to look like Gary Cooper.
Oh, interesting. Yes. What is that? What is that a line from?
Putting on the Ritz.
There you go.
And John Garcia.
I just wanted to play the song just real quick. Just a little sample for everybody out there. We may or may not be playing the song frequently throughout the podcast episode. I guess you'll just have to listen to find out.
What a song. This movie won an Oscar for its score and for that song. That seems to be just the whole score is just that song that they just play repeatedly throughout. And like, you'll forget about it and then it'll just slowly build up as from nothing to like the loudest thing on screen and then slowly disappear away. And it's just, you can't escape it. It's like, it seems like they just like one guy recorded it over the course of like 30 minutes just to get it out there, and they won a fucking Oscar for that.
I like how often it sounds like there's someone around the corner playing it. Like, you just expect Gary
was in the walls. Yeah. He had been, like, imprisoned until he couldn't leave the set until he was done.
Like, legend has it they buried the singing cowboy alive 30 years ago in the middle of the town.
If you
listen quietly, sometimes you still hear his wailing cry.
Built this town on an ancient burial folk singer.
We are talking about 1952's High Noon.
Ben Miller and Dolph Depot now with Jim Pearson, Jack Colby. They asked about the noon train.
The noon train?
And that ain't all.
They pardoned Frank Miller.
Please, Will, if you just tell me what this is all about.
They sent a man up 5 years ago for murder. He was supposed to hang. Now he's free.
I'll give you odds. Kane's dead 5 minutes after Frank gets off the train.
Some of you were special deputies when we broke this bunch. I need you again.
You're asking an awful lot, Kane, considering the kind of man Frank Miller is.
We all know what Miller's like. That's why I'm here. How about it?
You don't have to be a hero, not for me.
I'm not trying to be a hero. If you think I like this, you're crazy.
You risk your skin catching killers, and the juries turn them loose so they can come back and shoot at you again. And in the end, you wind up dying all alone on some dirty street where a tin star.
There's a limit how much you can ask a man. This is just plain committing suicide.
Directed by Fred Zinnemann, written by Carl Foreman, starring Gary Cooper, Grace Kelly, Thomas Mitchell, Lloyd Bridges, Lee Van Cleef. In his first screen role, and he's one of the first characters you see on screen, and he doesn't come back very often. But that's what we're talking about. I wanted to talk about this movie because I had seen it before, and it had been a long time, and I had always kind of wondered why this is thought of as one of the great American Westerns. And I never really understood why people were into it. And all of the lessons that people seem to take from it, I was like, no, you're wrong. That's the exact opposite of what you should take from this movie. And so it recently came out of 4K and I bought the disc and I was like, I would really be interested to see this again. And I think it would be a fun discussion topic on the podcast. So High Noon stars Gary Cooper as a marshal in this town named Kane. Marshall Will Kane. Yeah. Yes, the town is something else. I don't remember. Yeah. Who cares? And he is getting married to Grace Kelly, and they are getting married at the courthouse on Sunday morning, or at the marshal office, and
in front of a drunk. Imprisoned.
In front of a passed out drunk in a cell who's also in the room. We learned that Gary Cooper is his term as marshal is over. He has married a Quaker who is completely against violence, and she has required him to quit his job as marshal and move to a different town and open a store. And so he's excited about getting married, but doesn't really seem super psyched about, you know, giving up his lifestyle the way that he has slipped it before, and kind of domesticating himself. Then we learn very quickly that Frank Miller has been pardoned, and he is a murderer that Gary Cooper put in jail several years ago. Apparently the town was just this crazy, wild, anarchic hellhole before he arrested Frank Miller, and then it became this wonderful, classic American place where good women could walk the streets with no fear. And now Frank Miller has inexplicably been pardoned, and he's coming to... And we don't even know this, but we assume that he's on the noon train because some of his old friends have gotten into town and are asking about the noon train. Mm-hmm. And so he's like, oh shit, well, we gotta, we gotta protect the town from evil Frank Miller. So, this movie, I think it's gonna be interesting to talk about this. It's about one guy who's like allegedly standing up for what's right and how everybody in the town is a weaselly little cowardly shit and won't like stand up with him and like do the right thing. I think this movie is actually just about a really stubborn, stupid man when everyone around him is like, hey, dude, chill out. And he just won't take the advice. he's trying to get a posse throughout the movie to, you know, save the town against Frank Miller because when Frank Miller comes back into town, just going to turn to a shithole again and, you know, just going to be crazy outlaws running around everywhere. And we have no evidence to back this up. That's just what he thinks is going to happen, and he feels like it's his duty, even though he is no longer Marshall, to do this because the new Marshall will not arrive until the next day. So that's kind of the idea of the movie. A lot of it is him going around trying to convince people to join him in his efforts against Frank Miller. The movie basically takes place in real time. It's really cool the way it's edited. He finds out about Frank Miller at like 10:40, and then he's coming in on the noon train, and the rest of the movie is about 80 minutes long, and there's a lot of clocks on the walls and the different places that he goes to in the town, and you kind of feel the tense nature of the movie as the time is ticking down and you're getting closer to this inevitable showdown. So it's really interesting the way it's constructed, and I think there are a lot of things about this movie that are really well done. I also think it's kind of poorly acted for the most part. I don't really like Gary Cooper or think he's a very good actor. He is kind of overly stoic and just kind of does the same thing in every movie that he's in. This is Grace Kelly's first role. She's kind of trying to figure out what she's doing, but hasn't really like established herself as a strong acting presence yet. But I think there are a lot of weak spots in the movie. The theme song is just so bad, and it keeps coming back in over and over throughout the movie. John and I were watching this and just kept laughing every time the theme song came back in. And supposedly, when this movie was screened originally for test audiences, people were laughing at it because the song was coming in like four times as much in the original cut than it is in the final cut of the movie. And I can't even imagine how it's possible to use that song more than it is in the current format. And, you know, they're like, oh, yeah, they cleaned it up and took a bunch of the song out. And now it's, you know, now it's great. It works perfectly. I mean, I don't know about that. Still pretty funny to me. But overall, I liked the movie because I think there are enough things that it does really well. The 4K restoration looked fucking incredible. It was really cool to see, a movie from 1952 in black and white just looks so, so sharp. But yeah, I'm really interested to hear what you guys have to say. Ryan, you've seen High Noon before. Yes. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, no, I've definitely, this is maybe third or fourth time I've seen it. This is one of the movies my dad liked quite a lot. He liked Westerns in general. So he liked both the classical like John Wayne Western and newer Westerns. This is probably one of the earlier Westerns I saw as a kid, because he typically only showed me like the decent ones. So none of the ones that were just like shooting a bunch of stuff. So even the John Wayne ones we saw were the better ones.
Yeah, the John Ford or Howard Hawks ones.
Right. And I remember liking it because it has such a like more chill pace, and it's this ticking clock scenario as this guy runs around town trying to get help. I remember Gary Cooper kind of being like a stoic, like good guy kind of, you know, role or whatever that he is. Watching it now reminds me a lot of Gregory Peck in To Kill a Mockingbird. And to find out that Gregory Peck turned down this role makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
that it was exactly what they were thinking. Seeing it now, it's interesting with everything I have seen since to kind of like see this as a really early anti-Western It came out, and I think it kind of, look, according to the reception, pissed people off because it really isn't like Westerns at the time. And it's a bit till I think we get to more what I would call a more true anti-Western. This one still has that, like, good guy, bad guy dynamic. Really, clearly, it's an anti-Western in that it isn't a bunch of shooting. It's a bunch of character dialogue, and which definitely was different. I agree. Gary Cooper, looking at it now, you're kind of like, it's very straightforward who he is. There isn't really depth. It's supposed to be someone who has, or, you know, is being challenged to come back or to leave, right? And I don't know that there's really that interesting range that you might see in a more auteur's hand, I guess, of how this movie could be made, you know, if I'm imagining it now. Grace Kelly's trying. She's new. But again, Gary Cooper's 50. Grace Kelly's 20.
Yeah.
But I noticed they're yeah.
Classic 1950s Hollywood, bunch, baby.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly what you would expect. Apparently, this movie pissed off John Wayne, which is unsurprising. Any decent Western that you see, probably that John Wayne isn't in, he doesn't like. It seems to be the theme. But
it's so crazy to me that, like, he did The Searchers, and yet he's so mad at other Westerns that he views as, like, un-American or have, like, heroes with questionable morals or something. And it's like, what? Are you serious? Did you ever see that movie after you shot it? Like,
yeah, I don't think he gets it. I think he got what he was doing, which is fine, because that's what the character in The Searchers is, a person that's not getting what's going on in the world around them. And this is 1 year before Shane, which I think is a more, like, that's always the one I point to, is to me, like, the first, like, end of the cowboy. The Searchers and Shane, to me, are, like, talking about the cowboy being over. This movie is more of the, like, anti-Western, like I said, in that, like, it just doesn't follow the Western formula, though it's
a Western. It feels like a question. It's like, is the cowboy over? And then it ends with, like, nah.
I still think this is enjoyable. I do think this is one of the better Westerns, especially if you're going back and you're like, hey, I want to watch something from the 50s. I think this is a good example of something a little bit different in the 50s, you know, as a slower character piece. The ticking clock is interesting, right? It lines up time-wise with what's going on. It is interesting looking at it now, and yeah, with what you're saying, Dixon, it is sort of interesting that everyone disregards him. I guess there's an argument in a church where a few people maybe start to think they might join him, except for the drunk and a child, more or less, are the only other people who are insane enough to be like, yeah, we want to help you. that should kind of make you question what you're doing. It's unclear, like, everyone's convinced that this guy's going to come back and he wants to get Kane. Like, Miller's going to come back and he's going to kill Kane. But it doesn't mean the town is immediately going to go to shit like it used to be.
No.
Or that he's intending to kill anyone else. So it's another one of these, like, if he's just sticking around, he's only leading himself to trouble. So he pretty much should just leave. Like, and then why would this guy necessarily stay in town and fuck anything up? Like, right, he really is kind of making a poor decision. I can also see the ending pissing off John Wayne because the women actually do something, like, and are in it. And it's sort of Wayne said it was, like, anti-American. I actually think that's not the case, because this does feel like the kind of classical Western of, like, he's standing for the badge. He's standing for the office in spite of all the things against him. Yeah. He's trying to create this law and order in this Wild West situation that I'm like is kind of the stupid American tale of the West. Like, this does to me fall in the, like, idealized West bullshit. Especially with, you know, our hero winning and it honestly being like a clean win, right? I guess that barn burned down, but nothing else really. So I liked it. I still liked watching it again. It's just been interesting looking at how it's aged. And seeing where cinema has come since. But John, what's your thoughts?
Somebody who's never seen High Noon and has consumed an intense amount of Italian Westerns and also a lot of post-Western cinema. And I haven't really dipped back into classic Western recently. And the only other thing that I mentioned watching it with Dixon was High Plains Drifter. I was like, this is the town from High Plains Drifter. Like, fuck all of these people. They will get what's coming to them soon enough in this purgatory that they call whatever the fuck the town is. I thought that it was good. It is watchable from a classic standpoint. You do have to prime yourself. Like, you either have to love the genre, appreciate the genre, or understand that things were handled differently in terms of storytelling back in like the 50s. Because I laughed a good number of times at just how much exposition is foisted on you in every fucking scene. And also, even in, as we've alluded to, the song, there is exposition.
The song tells you the whole plot of the movie right off the jump.
Yeah, and like, I understand there's like this transition of, you know, we used to be orators. We used to sing the songs and stories to people, and then we put them on stages and we would sing about them there too. And like, sure, why not? There's a campfire song to tell a story, but you're watching a movie. You don't need to be sung to about what's going to happen in the movie to just watch the movie and see it.
Do not forsake me, oh my darling.
And it just like, it's one of those things where like I started to get annoyed because there were scenes where I was like, you could just let this play out. You could let this breathe and it would be way more intense. It would have way more of an effect. And there instead is this insistence on running a stage play, a production in which you have very visible or audible cues to make things happen. Like the Lloyd Bridges fight that goes on between him and Gary Cooper, no music in that. Don't put the Twilight Zone music in this. Like, we don't need whatever this conflict music is. Just let them duke it out and have the silence and their heavy breathing as they try to beat the shit out of each other. And it would make it way more intense. Or have Lee Van Cleef and crew ride into town and talk about their plan without knowing what the plan is. We see them talk and we just hear, do not forsake me, oh my darling. And I'm just like, why? Like, what are you? And there were so many things that I was just like, in a retrospective lens, like, you could have done it this way. You could have done it like, who did not have the wherewithal? And so to me, it came off feeling like much more of like a made for TV movie, like an adaptation of like a Gunsmoke or like any of those like classic Western stories. I still did like the ticking clock aspect of it. I really did find some really cool shots in it too. Like they attached the camera to like a wagon when it's moving. And that was a really nifty like way to show things moving in motion. There are a lot of, even with the 4:3 ratio, it is 4:3, right?
Yeah.
They still managed to get some really cool like landscape shots that are pretty awe-inspiring and they get the scale in there. I don't know how the score in the song won an Academy Award because I just...
Shocking.
I felt nothing when I listened to them.
The editing also won an Academy Award, deservedly so.
Yeah.
And then so did Gary Cooper. True. I'm like, what?
Wait. Yeah, Gary Cooper. the guy who's doing a Joe Biden impression in his own wedding.
Yeah.
Like, turns around and like hugs his wife. Like, oh yeah, she's on camera. like there were so many moments where I was like, this could have been done better. And especially, yeah, I would say the most egregious for me, it was just the exposition. Like, I laughed a number of times through the movie because people would just show up and be like, I've been the judge in this town for 15 years and I ain't never done nothing wrong. I'm not going to fuck with Frank. There's no way that I'm going to. You remember what Frank did 12 years ago when he came to you and did? And I was like, oh, my God, like. Just show anything but this.
They never tell us what Frank did.
They never tell us what Frank did. They just talk about like, it's like they put placeholders in the script and then they're like, we really don't need that though. Like, we just need to know that Gary Cooper, Frank's coming. And it just, after a while, like the shots of the train rails agitated me where I was like, I get it. I know Frank's coming. You show the clocks, you show the train rails. Fine. Why don't you show the thugs fucking shit up more? Like, why wouldn't Lee Van Cleef in the town stumbling around asking questions, or a tense scene between the marshal and them where they goad him. I would love that. That would be great. Mm-hmm. And that's still in a classic Western vein, but no, let's not do that. Let's make this It's a Wonderful Life in the West, except nobody comes with to Uncle Billy. George Bailey's. Yeah, Uncle Billy's there, mm-hmm. but Uncle Billy's against George Bailey. Nobody dumps a bunch of silver bullets into his basket at the end to bail him out. And so like, those parts frustrated me. That being said, I did have a good time watching this still. I did enjoy it. It's just like, it rode that line for me where I was like, I don't know how much of this is me as like a film, like just a film buff, really loving the act of people making something or seeing these things, and which part of this is, you know, I'm actually entertained as opposed to I'm appreciating it. And so to ride that line and not lose me in it, kind of like a demerit in a way.
Yeah.
So that's just my initial take on it. I'll kick it back over to you, Dixon.
Yeah. Interesting. So yeah, I agree with a lot of what you said, John. I think there are so many scenes where they're playing that stupid ass song that would have been so much more tense with no music at all. Like, just let the scene breathe and let the actors do their thing, and like would have been a lot more tense movie, and I think more engrossing with, you know, pulling that out and not always playing it in the middle of every fucking scene. I see your finger over there by that button, John.
Yeah, it's ready. It's ready.
Yeah, and so I think that's definitely a problem with the movie, and it does impact the pacing. Like, the editing is so good, but the song kind of throws off the pacing and makes it weird. Like, every time he has to walk from one building to another, they play that fucking song and all this stuff. I don't know, it's interesting. I want to talk more about, like, Gary Cooper's character and what the dynamic is in this town. So it seems like Sunday morning when he's trying to go get this posse together, everybody is either in church or at the saloon, and the saloon is popping at 11 a.m. There's just people just drinking entire bottles of whiskey and going wild. And it seems like a very split town where you have these people who want to go to church and live like well-to-do Christian lives. And Gary Cooper is kind of representing that group at the expense of the rest of the group in town that maybe is, you know, has a different moral standard or maybe different ideas about sexuality. Like, there's that hotel clerk that's kind of feminine that's like, yeah, not a lot of us like, you know, what Gary Cooper's been doing. You know, we want the old ways back where, you know, it wasn't such like crazy strict laws. And I think it's an interesting dynamic there in the town. And like, both sides kind of don't really seem to care to try to defeat the other one. It's just Gary Cooper that is trying to like iron fist his way through all of this and to force the town to be what he wants it to be before he leaves and goes on. But Ryan, you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, it is kind of weird to think about this being on like a Sunday, because it's like a guy getting a haircut, and you're right, there's some shit that's just regular shit going on, even though it's a Sunday in this time. Yeah, I think that the movie is a little bit at odds with this being a town that now is like supposedly all together. Like, he's cleaned it up and he's brought it in and people want to live here. And they mention like, oh, if there's a shootout, people won't want to come into town anymore, or we'll be seen as like a crappy town. I'm kind of like, I don't really know with the town why it's there. This is one of those like failings from a Western background, where it's just like all the towns look the same and it's unclear why, you know, or where everyone really lives or what they do. So it is sort of like that literal facade of a town that it is. And again, there, I think it would be interesting for them to get a little more into it, because even the people in the church, there are some of them, they're like, hey, we liked the Millers, right? Like, a few of the people are like, well, we don't have a problem with them coming back. But they just sort of just say that. We don't really get, again, with any background of like,
yeah, who, no matter what people say,
who they were,
Kane just pushes through.
Yeah.
And the movie never acknowledges that he ignores people. He'll talk to somebody and they'll be like, you know, I honestly think these things. And he's like, ah, you won't help me. I'll go get my own posse somewhere else.
Right.
Yeah.
He doesn't listen to anyone.
And he never gets a comeuppance for it either. He gets like shot in the leg and that's like it, or something. I don't know. He gets shot in the gut. He probably dies shortly after this movie's over. But
we can only hope.
Yeah. Yeah, but we never see any of that. And like, there's shit that he's an asshole about too, because even when he goes up in that church to he's like, I don't mean to interrupt your preaching, Padre, or whatever the fuck he says. And the guy's
Parson.
Like, yeah. And he's like, you kind of did already. And then he's like, well, I just need a posse for these things. And then he's like, you know, my wife, she's a Quaker. And he like fucking whispers it to him in like this asshole way in front of the congregation.
Well, the pastor calls him out for not getting married at the church. Yeah, like he's being very petty also.
Yeah. They're both being petty and it's never really acknowledged. It just kind of happens. Like all these conflicts are just brought up and nobody really reconciles with them. Whereas, as I had alluded to, High Plains Drifter, everybody's awful and Clint Eastwood is there to fuck their shit up the entire time. He's the angel of reckoning. The angel of death and the reckoning is at hand. That is what it
is.
and here it's just like, no, everybody just gets to be an asshole and the town just continues to function. Like Uncle Billy comes up and undercuts Gary Cooper's passionate plea with a much more passionate. It was like the only thing that really engaged me was Uncle Billy's fucking monologue about how good things actually could be if Gary Cooper just left.
He gives by far the best performance in this movie. He's actually very good in it.
Yeah. But yeah, just like those moments are never acknowledged. So I get it. Yeah, that is, it's a very odd way to perceive it rather than the movie having characters look in on themselves and ask, like you could have that Quaker thing be something. And I don't know if this can be classic or if it borders on post-Western, but to just have that dispute, there's already a dispute between husband and wife. They're already disagreeing about something philosophically.
Mm-hmm.
Why not have this weird aversion to Quakers be something that factors into it? But now it's just mentioned. It's just kind of like 1950s America was like, oh yeah, Quakers. Fuck that. I get it.
Yeah, I think the Quaker aspect was supposed to be her extreme pacifism.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was a mechanism to justify that.
Yeah, stance. That like the... you know, Gary Kane can go to the church and be like, hey, who wants to join the posse? And that's not really a concern for people in the church, even though I think they do mention that, right? Doesn't the pastor say something like the Bible condemns murder, but
thou shalt not
people?
Kill, despite the fact that there's so much more of the Bible.
Yeah. Well, but he's like, but we hire people to do it for us or whatever.
I love that he has a crisis in the middle of trying to refute
of his own faith. But the Kane's wife, you know, she became a Quaker because her family was killed, and that's why she's the one that's like, I'm out. If Miller's coming, I'm getting on the train and going the other way, I'm out. It is interesting having that. I think that the Quaker piece is specifically for the extreme pacifism to then see her not be pacifist at the end and actually come back.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's an interesting dynamic between those two characters, right? Like... the movie seems to be on Gary Cooper's side, and like, you know, Mrs. Ramirez is talking to Grace Kelly and like, oh, I don't understand why you wouldn't stand by your husband. You know, you need to support him. You need to fight for him, blah, blah. And like the movie is like pushing her to do that. And the character development is that she throws away her pacifism in order to save her husband. Mm-hmm. But like they got married knowing he knew that she was a Quaker, that she was a pacifist, and like, you know, agreed to quit his job and go start a shop and have it live a peaceful life. And then immediately breaks that vow as soon as they get married. And he's like, you know what? I'm killing again. We're doing it. And she like justifiably is like, what the fuck? You just went back on this promise that you made to me that you would stop committing violence and like live a peaceful life. And like she has every right to be pissed and to leave him and all that. He is like a huge asshole, does not really seem to care about their marriage at all. And she has this really tragic arc, I think, where she has to end up, killing someone, shooting somebody in the fucking back in order to save her husband and, you know, try to save whatever she thinks that relationship might be. But it's like, you know, I feel like it's a very tragic story for Grace Kelly's character having to go through that. Like she has to be so fucking traumatized. Like, you know, you don't see after the movie when she's like bawling her eyes out and probably has PTSD from that for years and years and struggles to like be a good wife and mother because she's haunted every night by killing someone, you know? Like,
There's those philosophical questions of like, you know, how far can you take pacifism before you're just like pushed over to do anything?
Not very far.
And, yeah, not very far. And, you know, you have to, there is like, even if you're nonviolent, there is an allotment of violence that must be maintained to keep yourself like asserted in the world. Like it's like even Buddhists who are, you know, pacifistic or nonviolent can rise up and fight. to preserve themselves. And it makes sense, like, in that way. Otherwise, you just get trampled. And so the movie could have done something with that, but no, it doesn't. Instead, it's like she killed for her man. And it ultimately is a reductive mechanism, to me anyway, that just is like, you should just do anything for your man. You should just, they like have a big old grandiose shot of her wedding ring at the end when she hugs him after she fucking murdered a man. And it's very much like, you should do anything, ladies, anything. And like, it just is like, yeah, no, I don't think so. When your guy goes from place to place, punching bartenders just for shit talking him and then faux apologizing after that, like, I don't know, there's a certain point at which you should just have your men committed, you know. I'm sorry, like, they just get them tied up and on a train out of town, like, fuck off, like, it doesn't need to happen.
Like, at what point is Gary Cooper the violence in the town, right? You know, like, he is going against what everybody wants him to do. He's not even the marshal anymore. He's trying to, like, assert his will on everybody around him. Yeah, he's assaulting random people for no reason. Like, you know, you start to see why some people would be like, hey, like, get the fuck out of here. Like, maybe Frank Miller isn't any worse than you are. You know, it's just a different side, just enforcing a different value system upon everyone with the same type of violence.
There's also, I can also see why John Wayne came in, Ryan, and was like, this isn't an American movie, because the bad guys, they don't do shit for a majority of the movie. They're only there for one man, for Gary Cooper. And they don't cause any trouble in the town that I can see.
They sit on the bench.
They sit on a bench and they wait. And one of them goes to the saloon because he's thirsty. And everybody welcomes him there. It's like a homecoming parade where they're just like, look at this fucking guy. He's back. Hey. And they're asking him questions. And he's just grabbing a drink and he's smiling and having a good time. And like, they're here to kill one dude. They have, you know, sins of the father. There's a lot of revenge. That's some Old West shit. Sure. They're not doing anything to the town yet. And it's like a Minority Report thing for Gary Cooper. Just being like, they're going to do bad shit. I can tell.
Yeah.
I didn't even need to talk to them to know that they're up to no good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I would have at least liked one scene where they indulged and he went to the train station, because everybody talked about how they're there. They're just hanging out. And that seems like the kind of thing where he would show up and be like,
get out of here.
Not even get out of it. It'd be like something sly. You know, I would think that they want to make Gary Cooper kind of charismatic in some way. And they'd be like, you boys waiting for the next train? And they'd, you know, have some exchange there of like, yeah, we ain't purchased our tickets yet. Like, that kind of shit where you're like sizing each other up and trying to see exactly what's going on. Like, God, I would have wanted one of those scenes and not just Gary Cooper's a madman banging on doors, disturbing people and trying to round up a posse to fight a threat he thinks is coming.
Yeah.
The movie,
it's like
just
the day before the election, going around trying to raise money.
Yeah. It's exactly. Just those sequences. I can see why John Wayne was like, they don't kill enough people. These aren't really bad guys. This doesn't feel like an American Western. Also, let's not even talk about the two Native American people who have no dialogue and are on screen for 2 whole seconds. That's fine. That was just there for the representation of the Old West. It's fine.
Otherwise, how would you know this was the West?
The saloon playing piano and stuff.
I do think that the intention of the movie, the intention of the story is more that in the face of this impending, you know, violence or problem that Kane has every reason to run away from. He's no longer the marshal. He's married. He's supposed to be a pacifist now. The town doesn't give a shit. They don't want him to do this. They all tell him to run away, that he still stands there for the what's right. And I think the idea is supposed to be that his wife, also initially going to flee, deciding to become a pacifist because of what she sees, turns around and comes back and does face it. Like, I think that's supposed to be the point, but that is like a paper thin where I'm like, this movie's kind of waffles between being a classical Western that's like, oh, the martial role is important and he's standing up for what's right, and an anti-Western in that, like, no one wants that.
Yeah.
Right. And the town might even just accept the quote bad guys.
I have a question that's fun and political for us.
Oh, great.
Is this a movie that was successful and or was appealing to pro-war sentiments in the Korean War, which was going on 1950 to 1953? This is a 1952 film. This is about a man who believes firmly in standing up for what's right, and that other people just don't see what's coming, and that we need to justify like unrelenting force in a unanimous way.
There are there are people that interpreted this movie as an allegory for the Korean War.
Okay.
Also, the screenwriter was a member of the Communist Party in the 30s, and then ended up being, he was supposed to be a producer on the film, ended up getting called before Congress to name names, and fled the country to England. And so they removed his producer credit. He still, you know, got the screenwriter credit for the movie. His name's Carl Foreman. John Wayne bragged about getting him kicked out of Hollywood.
Of course he would.
And like some people view the movie, and at the time, people on the right in America criticized High Noon for being about the about HUAC and about, you know, communists in Hollywood, and how, like, you know, Foreman is writing this movie about himself as somebody who is trying to do the right thing, but nobody will stand up for him and nobody will help him out. And I don't know how much of that is true. You know, all these, there's a lot of different interpretations. I feel like people see what they want to see out of the movie. You know, I see it like, oh yeah, this guy's just fucking stupid and he won't listen to anybody. And like, this should be an obvious movie about how, like, you should be pacifist and you should be slow to just jump into violent situations, like weigh your options and be smart about things. But yeah, there's a lot of different interpretations of what the film was about. So many U.S. presidents have screened this movie at the White House multiple times. Reagan, W. Bush, and Clinton have all said it's their favorite movie. Clinton supposedly screened it 17 times at the White House. And I'm just thinking, like, man, how many wars did this movie inspire? Like, did this inspire George Bush to go into Iraq when no one else would stand by the U.S. at the United Nations and all these things? Like, you know, did this inspire countless foreign coups by Reagan and Clinton and all these things? Like, you know, how much destruction in the world is because of this fucking movie?
It's amazing. Yeah. And it's one of those that definitely I can see it emboldening just anybody, really, because it's about one man's unhinged quest to justify what he does.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, anybody, when you look at that, you can apply it to anything. It's totally good Rorschach for you in a classic Western sense.
I just can't imagine like a president watching this movie and being like, yeah, I'm the guy that's standing up for all these fuckers I have to govern who don't appreciate me. And I'm the one that has to make the hard decisions and, you know, fight all these wars and stuff. And the public just doesn't get it, you know, but I have to stand up and do what's right. And it's lonely. And maybe my wife's pissed at me, but I don't care. I got to do the right thing. You know, like, what the fuck are you like? It's just wild.
Yeah, and that's where, like, I guess that's the fault of, it's interesting to think about it, but like, in my opinion, this is bad writing that can influence bad thoughts. Like, it's the equivalent of like your modern day Michael Bay, who can be co-opted to have stories about bad boys for life and or other characters who should be justified in what they're doing. But it's really more the film language, the way the film is told, that tells you that they're that way, and not so much, you don't feel it ever. It's like, it feels like wrestling to me. It feels like there's a facade within it, where you've always had in classic Westerns, white hat, black hat kind of styling of these are the bad guys because they're the fucking bad guys. That's all you need to know. Uh-huh. And it plays so well to like contemporary politics, just like the general politics, the other, in the sense that it is vague enough to show you the struggle of somebody, the facade of the struggle of somebody who could just leave at any point. Mm-hmm. And they never sit down and talk about it. There's not a fireside chat where, you know, in this movie, if Gary Cooper, if it didn't take place over the course of an hour and a half, they could have time for a nighttime chat with somebody. Instead, he has a fist fight with Lloyd Bridges in a barn. But like, you just get those moments where he could sit quiet. And let's say at the end of that fist fight with Lloyd Bridges, exhausted, he's propped up against the fucking stable side. And he's like, well, I just don't understand why you won't fucking show up for me. And like, just have that moment of Lloyd being like, well, did you ever think you were fucking wrong? Like, do you ever think that these things, do you ever any of this? Like, no, everybody is an aggressor and an oppressor and mm-hmm. opposite to him. And none of them are justified in the language of the cinema. Like the actual way that any of the shots are shown, he's in like heroic. You see the sweat on his brow and the stress in his eyes. Everybody else is carefree and ignorant and stupid. And that's the way that the film is told. And I can see why presidents would love that, because it's like, I want to be that guy. Mm-hmm. I want to go out there. Let me at him. Fuck it. So it's I don't know what y'all's thoughts on that are. That's my rant for today.
Yeah, I think the like extremely simplistic view of this movie, if you just absolutely look at it as surface simply, I mean, the song lyrics say it as well over and over. It pretty much is there's this impending, this person's going to come kill you. Gary Cooper seems to think that he's going to chase him down wherever they go, but I don't know that I buy that. And it's this, like, do I run away and live a coward, or do I stay here and die, but I, you know, I guess whether you're a hero or whatever, at least you're not a coward, right? Yeah. And kind of just standing up for it. And so I can see, yeah, there's that really nice, you're right, like, George Bush seeing himself in that of like that he's not the coward running away from Iraq. I don't know where how that falls apart, but
But it's also funny because like I think of having not seen this film before, going into it, High Noon as a concept in classic Western mythology is the sun's coming down and you're going to have a fucking shootout with these, rebels, these criminals, whatever, in the center of town. You're going to settle your dispute with one act of violence, but there is honor around it. There is a rule system to enforce that. And here, in kind of a counter to that, because I anticipated the end of this movie being he would have some showdown with them.
Mm-hmm.
It's really fucking scrappy, surprisingly scrappy, where he's like, no, like you actually got to think about this shit. You know, hide behind these barrels and try to like take a pot shot at somebody, shoot one guy, leave him dead, and you run into a barn, and then they try to smoke you out. And it's like, you know, the battle kind of evolves from there in what they're trying to do until suddenly your wife's involved and now she's got a gun. At that point, I was also just like, he never tried to convince anybody else as well to take a rifle and go hang up top on the roofs, on the rooftops, mm-hmm. and try to like shoot these guys when they come into town. Like, I feel like that's a more persuasive hide and cover and shoot like a coward thing.
Mm-hmm.
But instead here, it's just like, I'm not going to do the official showdown where we shoot each other. I'm not going to convince anybody else with more persuasive strategy or tactics. I'm just going to show up and see what happens. And we're going to have a sloppy fight. And it's weirdly antithetical to what I think of as classic Western in a way.
Yeah. It's very anticlimactic, I think. Like you think there's going to be this big showdown in the streets and this, you know, like the tumbleweed rolls across and you have to zoom in on the eyes and all, but you don't get that. Instead, you get actually kind of a cowardly approach by Cooper, where instead of actually talking to them and being like, hey, what's going on? Heard you're, you know, you're out of jail. Congratulations. What are you doing? What are you doing in town? You know, like, doesn't ever ask him if he has a vendetta against him and wants to kill him. He shoots first at them. He shoots at their back, like yells at them to turn their head to have the, you know, the guise of giving them a fair fight, and immediately starts shooting at them.
It's coming right for us.
Yeah.
It's like he is clearly the aggressor in this situation, mm-hmm. right? He is instigating the violence, and he doesn't even fucking know if Frank Miller wants to kill him. What if he's a changed man in prison and wants to come back and shake his hand and you know, say, hey, sorry, I want to move on with whatever I, you know, did before and live a new life. We don't know, you know, because they never ask.
Yeah.
Supposedly he told somebody that he was intending to come back to kill Kane specifically.
That's what ruins it for me, because I would love
through the grapevine, I guess.
I would love if I was thinking about this film wrong. Like, if I was wrong about it having overtones of this grandiose hero in the streets, even as cowardly as he approaches it, we've kind of put the building blocks in place of like, this is on that cusp of post-Western. This is that cusp of an anti-hero, somebody who's mad enough to like Matt isn't crazy enough to just assume that a man can never change and to gun him down in the streets in cold blood. Like that to me is a great skewering of Western mythology and the righteousness of a marshal. But there's so many tells within the film, and maybe this is because, again, the screenwriter was driven out of the States and yeah. they took over the film and were like, yeah, fuck that, change this, change that, whatever else, that now it is this hodgepodge patchwork of, no, he is actually the hero. He's totally grandiose all the way through. They show scenes of Frank being like, where is he? I'm going to kill him. Whereas if Frank got off the train and was like, hey, boys, it's good to see you. I'm glad I'm back in town. Let's go to the saloon. And they're joking and talking about it, and they're all walking and having a good time. There's no animosity intended towards what's going on. They've made their peace with it. And then he's just like, hey, boys, and like fucking guns one of them down.
Yeah.
And immediately they're thrown into a frenzy. Totally different lens there than what is projected, which is a little more confusing in terms of the story told. But
yeah, and then you end the movie with Cooper throwing his badge into the dirt and leaving town, and like that is supposed to be, you know, this big classic shot in cinema is like, you know, oh, all you people are shit, like I'm you know, you won't stand up for what's right,
me.
Yeah, like go fuck yourselves, I'm leaving town, I saved your town for you, now you're on your own, and I'm leaving now. And it's like he kills all these four guys by himself, and despite being just beat up by a much younger man in the scene right before, like, you know, 5-10 minutes before these guys get into town. And it's so unrealistic, and I think just such a, like, I think this movie could be really powerful if he got shot and died in at the end of the movie, and then like the town just went on with its normal life, right? Like that would be incredibly powerful. If they're like, all right, well, okay, now that's over. Now we can just go back to our lives and we're done. You know, but the movie doesn't choose to go that way. And I think it could be just such a better movie if it made that decision.
Yeah, go get the dentist who makes the coffins and just dump the body somewhere. It's fine. Yeah, that was kind of also the disappointment. I know when it ended, Dixon, you were like, I feel like we have very similar opinions on this. And I was like, I 100% agree, because what the fuck was this ending? Where your wife that you've been arguing with for the entirety of the runtime suddenly comes to her senses and realizes that killing is good sometimes and that she should stand up for you, and she hugs you and like, you got shot, but you're still alive and you're not bleeding profusely and you're not bleeding out either. There's no dramatic, like I'm dying and I died for a cause that I wanted. He just gets to leave. And it's just like, okay. I think the only thing that I liked about this movie that like I really liked about it was that his ex-lover just left town and that they never looked back on that. She just like left and was like, nope, good, I'm fucking her. Done with this shit. Yep. Got out.
Sold enjoyed my business that. At a discount, got the fuck out.
Yeah, yes. I enjoyed that business conversation where she's like, I'm going to sell the store. Do you want to buy it? Okay, how much? 2,000. I don't have 2,000. How much do you have? 1,000. All right.
That, and then you give me the next 1,000 over 6 months, and the guy was like, yeah, sure, fuck it, and this works.
Yeah, we'll figure it out later, bye. Yeah, it was the fastest business deal.
Also, like, what's up with that drunk showing up and being like, look, if you need me, I can do anything, and
the one-eyed drunk.
Yeah, the one-eyed drunk. And Gary Cooper's like, no, and he's like, but I need this, like I need this for purpose, I need something in my life to do. And Gary Cooper's like, I'll let you know. And he never lets him know.
Why don't you go have a drink, buddy?
Yeah, he's so dismissive of other people, which, again, leads me to believe this was intended to be something else. And then it was kind of butchered after.
I don't know.
Yeah, feels like that. I think it's honestly like paper thin. I think it's so kind of paper thin that it's easy to put all these other things on it. But I really do think the idea here was like, it was just as simple, like, let's kind of subvert the Western. And you know, it's like, if you're telling this like a traditional Western, you have that, like, we know the gang is coming, we know they're gonna kill, we've heard it, we see it, we know they're bad guys, we see them shoot somebody at the beginning of the movie or whatever, right? That would kind of be your thing. And then our marshal, you know, tries to get everybody together, and then he stands there and they have the shootout and he shoots them down because he's righteous or whatever. And instead we kind of get this, like, not seeing any of the violence. It doesn't, our guy's a little old he's not the marshal anymore.
A little is an understatement.
Right.
He said, "Till death do you part," and I turned to Dixon and said, "It won't be long."
Yeah.
He's in the script. He was 35.
Yeah. Oh, man. Hollywood 35.
He turns down the drunk, even though it's like he should take anything he can get. He turns him down.
Mm-hmm.
He turns down the kid because the kid's like actually idealizing the violence.
Yeah.
Right. Where I can think of many John Wayne movies where he takes a kid that age or younger
as his second hand, he's just going
out hunting.
Yeah, there's no problem. And honestly, there's tons of like drunk characters that are, you know, your other heroes, right? So it's sort of like turning away all the things of the Western, and then to have a woman shoot the guy at the end, right? It's sort of like, let's take everything in a Western and kind of do the opposite. Not for any good reason, or not necessarily to say anything.
Just to be different.
Just to be like, you should watch all this, and to be like, oh, I wasn't a Western.
Ryan Johnson's Western. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
I think actually it does feel like an accurate representation of post-World War II America, right? Where like, you know, Gary Cooper's attitude does like about how America views the rest of the world and scary things, right? Like, you know, the 1950s, it's like you have the Christian suburban lifestyle that has been built on the backs of dead Europeans after the two world wars in a row. That is like, you know, anything that is different from our lifestyle and our way of living is scary, and we're not going to ask questions. We just don't want to deal with it, right? And like, I think not exploring the villain's motivation and what they're even there for is kind of part of that American fear of the foreign and the unknown.
Yeah.
And like, you know, oh, well, maybe Saddam does have weapons of mass destruction. We don't know. We didn't ask him. We've heard that he might. Let's just go kill him. Let's just go fight. Like, let's just go.
Let's get a posse together. Fuck it.
You know, like the post-World War II buildup of the military-industrial complex and the surveillance state and all these things that are kind of a fearful response to, you know, just being afraid of anything that is not what is strictly defined as American through a very narrow lens, like the John Wayne idea of what is American. I don't think that's what this movie is trying to do, but I think it's an interesting reflection of that idea.
Yeah, I would agree. Like that's kind of the general idea that I get from it, is because either that or it is playing with subversion in the safest way possible. Like it does not want to ruffle any feathers with what it's trying to present. And yet it does manage to upset people in how it reflects classic Western traditions. But yeah.
Yeah. One little tidbit that I saw on Twitter the other day, I have no idea if it's true, but it was a film critic on Twitter. I was talking about Lee Van Cleef, and she said that Van Cleef in High Noon asked for fewer lines because he thought it was like more menacing for his character.
That's rad.
And, you know, like Van Cleef is famously pretty silent in most of his movie roles. You know, he talks when necessary, but that's about it. And, you know, he likes to have that menacing, scary, silent character. And that was such a bold move for somebody in his first screen role to be like, can you give me fewer lines, please? Because I think that makes the movie better. I thought that was really cool.
I would have loved if that had been played out as a bit more of like a menacing gag. Again, this movie has a lot of things that I feel like it could have been more fun to...
Mm-hmm.
To get going, like if Van Cleef walked into, he plays Jack Colby, that's the character name he plays, and if he like walked into the saloon at the same time his other buddy did, and his buddy's over there talking, you know, chatting it up with everybody, Van Cleef's at the bar just looking, and the bartender's like, what can I get you? And like there's just nothing, and he just like gives him that face, and he's like, a whiskey? Oh yeah, whiskey would be good. Yeah. And he like pours it out, and he's like, one shot,
handshaking,
two shots. Okay, yeah. And
he just keeps looking until
he's done. Yeah, I'll just leave the bottle. Okay, and he like takes the shot himself and like leaves. Like that would have been just great. Just that tells you everything you need to know. It's menacing enough. Again, it fits within a classic Western mold.
Yeah,
it doesn't have to be a post thing, but there are just so many things. This movie, again, like as it captures. Even capturing that kind of like where America was and cinema was at that time. It's that dawn of like Westerns on TV And you could have reduced this to like a 30-minute episode, if that. Like, and I would have been like, okay, it gets everything across. Anytime they show the clock, it makes sense. Doesn't have to be real time. It could just be like, oh, time's progressing. I've seen this 1,000 times in Gunsmoke and Lancer and whatever else. Although Lancer was a newer edition. It's just one of those things where you're like, okay. But it just had so many opportunities that made me think of other things I liked about other Westerns.
Yeah.
Which is weird to have that pivotally. I remember when the screen flashed at the beginning, the Kino Lorber logo, I was like, couldn't help but notice it's not Criterion, Dixon. And I was just like, we're in for something that is probably a little bit more of a subtle cultural snapshot.
Mm-hmm.
Not so much a big bang. It's a something. But yeah.
Well, I mean, this is based on a short story,
allegedly,
essentially one of those like dime novel Westerns. Right.
Mm.
Yeah.
And yeah, so it is just like a straightforward, simple thing. You're right. It totally is like an episode drawn out to a movie length.
Mm-hmm. It's funny to think about it. When I was watching and the score sounded like, I said it sounded like a Twilight Zone episode. It really does feel like that kind of Twilight Zone ham-fisted vibe. Because it's one of those like, gosh, maybe somebody can help me form a posse. And like playing the twisted Twilight Zone music to make it a real like, oh God, that's unsettling. That you would have such aggressors and nobody to back you up.
Yeah.
It's just all those dramatic stings just tell you how you should feel.
Just tell you what the plot is.
Too, yeah, of course. Yes, as we all know, they do that.
What would I do if you leave me? Like that refrain kept playing over and over during the movie.
Every time that he talks. Yeah, we should talk about that scene where he runs up to, first of all, the person who manages the concierge of the hotel.
Mm-hmm.
Real shit stirrer, that guy.
Yes. Love that character.
Somebody liked to watch the world burn, and it was that man. It was just like, you're not staying here. You're going to catch the noon train. You're going to miss the fireworks. Like, your husband's going to be dead in the street, bleeding out. It's going to be great. Seeing
couldn't get
like
me to leave this town for all the tea in China.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, that whole sequence, too, where you would think that there's maybe a relationship like that. I don't even know why they got married anymore. Just watching the movie, I'm like, why did you get married? What exactly happened?
Because they're the two leads.
Yeah, you're the two leads. How did anything else happen in this? But like him showing up to the hotel and being like, well, you're still here. She's like, well, you changed your mind. And he's like, well, no, I didn't. Like,
I thought you changed your mind.
Yeah, you changed your mind. And then they both just are like, fuck you. That's like all that scene. I know that it's meant to emphasize like she's still deeply rooted in it so that later when she tragically goes against her values for him, that it can be meaningful. But it was just like, I'm here to see the woman that I used to have an affair with. Like march past her. Oh, man. Just stir in the pot. All these scenes.
Yeah. We haven't talked about maybe the smartest character in the movie, who is the guy who comes over to the marshal's office early on in the movie. He's like, hey, I heard that Frank Miller's coming in. I'll be with you. I'm joining the posse. Like, I want you to know you can count on me. It's like, great. And then he shows it back up later in the movie. He's like, all right, where are all the boys? I'm ready to go. And he's like, oh, yeah, I couldn't get anybody else. It's just me and you. And he's like, well, I'm out. Like, that's suicide, man. You're an idiot. Like, I'm not helping you kill yourself or me. Like, I got kids. I gotta go back to my family. Like, it's gonna help you out if you could actually raise a posse. But like, I'm not stupid.
Like, still some like posturing that happens from him, where he's like, if you want to leave, you can. And he's like, well, look, I got a family and I got kids and stuff. And it's just, you know, it's just like late, and I hear my mom calling. And the oven's on. I just don't even. I'm just gonna leave, man. Like, if I get out. Yeah, I loved that because I knew exactly where that was going. It was like, it was comedic timing.
Uh-huh.
It was almost like it was set up like a punchline at the beginning, because he comes in talking all fucking tough and then he just leaves. Like, can't even. I would love that. There's so many scenes that I would just love more stylistic touches to that I know can't be done. If there's a remake of High Noon, I will fucking see it, because I'm sure that person has the exact same thoughts I had.
Mm.
Where it's like that guy being, you know, have the drunk that's in the jail cell, because we just get like one scene with him where he's like, ah, thanks for taking care of me, Marsha, see you later. And he like walks out.
Mm-hmm.
Have that guy disagree more often, where like you get Gary Cooper and he's talking to the drunk in jail and he's just like, hey, Otis. I'm just going to assume his name's Otis.
That sounds right.
Hey, Otis. Yeah, Marshall. You ever think about sacrificing yourself for something nobler, a cause? And he's like, what do you mean? Like a discount at the liquor store or something? Like getting up earlier for that? He's like, no. Like just have those drawn out conversations. And then at the end, he still doesn't get it. Or have him feed into that conversation where the guy's like, I got a wife and I got kids. And, you know, I left the oven on. And he's like, you don't have an oven. Like, stay out of this, Otis. Like these little bits that I just would have loved to have seen more of. Instead, I feel like the movie is all business. And that
becomes
such a problem for me because there's not enough business to justify my tension and my attention. Like feelings behind it. They show that scene of the fucking rails, the train rails, so many times that I got desensitized to it. I was like, yep, I know he's coming. It's fine. I know he's out there. It's okay. And you show you guys waiting around, they're playing cards. Just nothing else really builds it. It's like they put all the players in position and told them to wait for an hour of the movie. And then they don't really do a whole lot to build it. So,
yeah, I would love to see a modern remake of this where Gary Cooper's character just gets shot and dies in the middle of the street.
Yeah. And do all of the things.
Like, that'd be wonderful. And they use like actually a real score, you know, to build tension, and that'd be great.
I'm going to write a letter to Kevin Costner. Maybe he'll find
it. Oh, no.
Maybe he would make it unknowingly, just like John Wayne did for The Searchers.
I know that they made a sequel with Lee Majors.
Really?
Called After High Noon.
Higher Noon.
Yeah.
Higher Noon. And there have been remakes. I don't know what they did or of what obviously not enough of a quality to even.
What are they like the Bruce register. Lee movies after Bruce Lee died?
Right.
They got like another Bruce Lee. Oh, man. Yeah, I don't know what those look like, but I assume because we're not talking about them, they did not make well.
It didn't work out.
Yeah.
It didn't do too well.
There were a couple shots that I wanted to call out that I really liked. One of those, I thought the 4x3 frame actually worked really well for that shot of the three guys standing at the train station, like as the train is coming up, and they zoom in on their faces, and like two of them are like cut off out of the frame, but it just has this very claustrophobic feel of like, evil is coming. it's encroaching upon your door. And then around that time too, they show Gary Cooper walking out to the middle of the town in the street, and there's a crane shot that zooms out from him like way up high over the whole town, and you see that he is just all alone and nobody is there to back him up. And I think that shot is just really powerful to kind of emphasize how out on an island he is and against the wishes and desires of everybody in the town around him.
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned already, you've got the scene of the wagon wheel where the camera's attached to that to show kind of the momentum in the passing through this town. It's like, there are interesting shots. There's cool alignment. There's also like really good camera work in it. Whenever Grace Kelly comes through to talk to Mrs. Ramirez, there's that whole sequence where she asks the concierge, like, which room is hers? And like the camera follows past the concierge, watches her walk up the steps, and there's like kind of interesting focal shifts. They rack focus in a really interesting way that I'm sure was prevalent at the time, but for me it was just like, it's always nice to see it and just appreciate it. It's like, oh, good camera work. It's not all just ones and twos and static shots from different angles. There were some scenes though where they just kind of were like, I could tell it was kind of on a budget. They just set the camera up and they let them go in a space.
Yeah.
Just talked about
stuff. I feel like there wasn't a consistent vision of how they wanted to shoot the movie. There were some shots that were really arresting and really good, and then others that were kind of boring. And I saw a feature on the movie that talked about how they wanted to shoot it almost in a documentary style. And I was like, ooh. I can kind of see that, but it's not really consistent in what they're doing. And when you have that fucking song keep coming up over and over, it doesn't feel like a documentary.
That's not very documentary.
Yeah. Should have just made that diegetic. The dude on a porch singing it, and Gary Cooper's like, Phil, give it up. Yeah. God damn it. Song's never going to take off.
Cool. Well, any other thoughts you guys have? I feel like we've talked through most of this. Anything you guys want to add?
Do you know another movie that came out in 1952?
Singing in the Rain.
That had songs in it.
Singing in the Rain.
Didn't get nominated for Academy Award.
Incredible. This one, best song in 1952. So fucking wild.
Ridiculous.
Yeah. Gene Kelly is just turning over in his grave. Just
yeah.
Cool. Well, thanks for joining us. I guess we should, you know, go around. Ryan, would you recommend this movie?
I do recommend it. I do think it's worth a watch. It's culturally relevant. It is a turning point in Westerns. It's had staying power. Presidents seem to be into it for whatever reason. So I do think it's worth a watch to get an idea of like where Westerns were at that time. It is a non-traditional Western, even though it's, you know, in older in people's eyes. I know that like Shane came out the next year, but and to take your own take of it, like see what you feel about it, see what you think afterwards.
It does seem that everybody kind of takes from it what they want and puts themselves onto the movie. So
it is rated often as like, you know, top 10 or best, you know, or close to the top Westerns. And
even American movies, like it's thought of as like one of the all-time great American films.
I don't really think it is. I don't think it's a great, like one of the all-time great American films at all. But even as a Western, I'm like, I don't know. There's so many Westerns that do revisionism or just outright anti-Western better. And then there are Westerns that are just strict, you know, Westerns that are more fun as well that are worth watching, right? So I'm kind of like, I just don't think you can really put this as a top Western like it's treated.
Yeah. But
it was really important. People really dig it.
Did Darla watch it?
No, none of them were interested in it. And it would have been like slow, boring, and like not a Western in a weird way for them to watch.
What did your dad like about the movie so much?
I think he probably likes it similarly the way the presidents like it.
That seems, people that really love this movie seem to have that one take man. On it.
I think it really is that. Yeah, he's a lawman that's staying around even though he shouldn't. He's not actually have the job anymore. His wife, you know, is against him. The town doesn't want his help, and he stands up for what's right, which it kind of is what the movie says. It's more interesting in the anti-Western aspects of like how it gets around to that, right? Because the normal Western, that sounds straightforward, but there'd be a lot of more shootout and he'd win outright in the duel, and it would be face to face, like a man, you know, faces him or whatever. And that's where this movie does all the opposite of it. So it just kind of does have like, it's a Western plot, it just does it in an anti-Western way.
Yeah
Well, John, would you recommend this movie?
No, I wouldn't recommend this movie. That's just my opinion. You've already heard a lot of my critiques about it. I have plenty that I would love to see yet of a remake of it. It's not that I didn't have a good time. It's just that there's so much else out there that I could recommend as an alternative to this. And I feel like this really just gets down to the nitty gritty of, you like Westerns, you should see High Noon. and check that out. But I can't just give a blanket recommendation of it. And come on, man, Gary Cooper's like 50 something, and it's just kind of that, it's that Vertigo vibe of Jimmy Stewart rubbing faces, except Gary Cooper doesn't have the fucking guts to rub Grace Kelly's face with his. And I'm thankful for that. He gives her like the briefest kiss when they get married after he remembers that she's his wife in the scene. And it's hilarious. But yeah, wouldn't recommend on this watch. Maybe I'll change my mind in the future. Maybe I'll come around to it in some other way. But yeah, first time through, nah.
Gary Cooper credited his performance as this pained, torn man to his stomach ulcers that he was going through at the time.
Okay, well,
apparently he was just literally in pain while filming this movie.
To find anybody to help him, and there's not a doctor in this town.
I would recommend this movie. When I first saw this, John, I had your same reaction. I was like, I don't like this. I don't get it. I don't really understand why people like it. I still feel that way in a lot of aspects about the movie, but I do think it does enough things well that it's worth watching. I think the editing is really impressive with the passage of time. And like, I don't know that that had really been done before up to this point. And I think, you know, you've got some good performances, you know, from Thomas Mitchell and Lee Van Cleef and some side characters that are interesting. So I think there's enough there to recommend. I also think it's...
yeah. I'm sorry, what? Go on.
I also think... it's a fucking song. I also think it is... you know, I think it's interesting to see what the movie is trying to say and how that might be wrong and how it could be interesting in a different way and what it says about America and how we think about ourselves and all these things. And I would definitely recommend watching it. I think it is an interesting movie, even if it is not, you know, does not maybe share my values or doesn't like do what I would like the movie to do. So.
Yeah, totally get that.
Cool. Well, thank you for joining us this week. I have been your host, Michael Dixon, with me as always.
Ryan King. John's just going to play the song like over all of us. That's actually going to be the outro.
You know, that's exactly what I want to do. Yeah.
And?
John Garcia, do not forsake me, my dear listener. Yeah, there we go.
What would I do if you leave me?
Thanks for putting up with bullshit. Do not
forsake me, oh my darling, on this our wedding day. Do not forsake me, oh my darling. Wait, wait long. If I'm a man, I must be brave, and I must face that deadly killer. Are I a coward, a craven coward? Are I a coward in my grave?
Hey there, movie buffs, TV toughs, and all listeners in between. John here from the Afterthoughts podcast. I just wanted to drop in at the end of this episode and say thanks for listening. If you've got afterthoughts of your own to share, hit us up. You can find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at The Afterpod, or jump into a conversation on our Discord server. You can find info for this and more at theafterpod.transistor.fm. Thanks again for listening, and we'll catch you on the next episode.